On today's hiwatt soundbite, we're breaking down a mix from the archives. The very first time that I ever heard this song, I got so excited.
Linger tasting rotten soil within the baker's deadly toll. In the morning's dirty rash, the rush hour's kissing ass.
I just love this track, Warning by Skinny Puppy. And you know, from the very earliest stages that I heard the demo of this song, I knew it was gonna be an absolute killer and a blast to work on. When Ogre and Mark delivered the final vocal on this track, oh man, it just brought this thing together in a really good way. Sort of like the glue that brought it all together. It's just so cool. So for today's session, I went back to the original TDM session of Warning and I restored it and brought it into my own system here. I had to print some of those TDM effects from that old rig. And just thought it would be a blast to sort of break down this mix and listen to the various elements, you know, drum programming and instrumentation and some of the really cool effects that are going on. So what a great opportunity to just sort of have fun with this track, bounce around, listen to a few different things. Haven't got it completely organized here, so, you know, we'll just bounce around and have some fun listening to this track. For starters, let's just kind of isolate some of these parts that are making up this intro.
Tasting rotten soil within the baker's deadly toll. In the morning's dirty rash, the rush hour's kissing ass.
Yeah, I love the way Ogre delivered this first vocal line, and there was just something so effective about leaving it dry and right in your face for the first half of this intro. We introduce a stereo reverb on the voice halfway through this intro. Check it.
Linger tasting rotten soil within the baker's deadly toll. In the morning's dirty rash, the rush hour's kissing ass.
Yeah, so cool. Let's listen to that kind of distorted reverb sound that comes in halfway through all by itself. Yeah, that's a total Mark Walk effect. I can just hear that tone. You know, he did a really cool thing here. I can see that he used a double vocal for that source. That effect is not feeding off the main lead vocal. It's feeding off a doubled vocal track. Yeah, I've mentioned this in past sessions. This is a really effective use of a double track, is using that double, as long as it's really performed well, to use that double track to feed into an effect that you're actually putting on the main lead vocal. It's such a cool effect, and it worked really well here. And the very last lyric of this vocal feeding into that long regenerating delay, check it.
In the morning's dirty rash, the rush hour's kissing ass.
Now, just an interesting side note about this delay. It's a little bit out of time with the track. You know, I noticed that I didn't have that delay time synchronized to the tempo of the track. Very interesting. You know, just for curiosity, I went in and I synchronized that delay to the tempo of the track, and it absolutely did not work anymore. That repeating delay is running a little bit faster than the tempo of the track, and it creates an awesome vibe for that kind of intro. I bring up that point because not all the time do you want your delays to be necessarily locked in sync with the track. There's absolutely nothing more cool than a regenerating delay sort of falling out of sync with the track in a cool way. Some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. Oh yeah, this track called Clicky, guaranteed that's a Mark Walt contribution. You know why I know that? Mark is always paying attention to melody. Even when the guy's writing a hi-hat part, he figures out how to put the kind of root note into it. Unreal. Now, another thing that Mark did on this intro that I really, really dig, he took the main bass sequence that Kevin did, and he sort of put it into a really different space for this whole intro. It's like he put a bit of distortion on it and kind of put it into a room. When you take a track like a bass sequence and you put it in an incredibly different sounding space, you create an opportunity to have that space disappear and change to something very, very new and in this case, very dry. This is just a particularly effective means of transitioning from one section of a song to another. And that's exactly what Mark did here. After Ogre delivers that very first vocal line, the drums all kick in, right? Well, right on that downbeat, Mark switches that kind of distant bass sequence that's been running to this dry, in-your-face bass sequence that Kevin provided, and it is so effective. Check out how it sounds soloed. Yeah, really, really effective. If I drop that vocal in, check it.
Rush hours kissing ass.
Well, Mark did a killer job of this, and I often refer to this kind of thing as the vacuum effect. Taking a sound and putting it in a really different space, and then just editing right on a downbeat of a track or any particular spot that you're looking to transition, and just go to a radically different tone of the same sound. Did a really good job of it here. I wanted to sort of take it another step. When Ogre comes in after the eight bars and starts singing the real first verse of the song, I wanted that bass track to kind of step up another notch. Just made a whole bunch of edits and made it really, really tight. Sort of made some space between the notes, so to speak. Check it out. Yeah, that's just something I get up to all the time. It's just sort of getting in and manually gating things sometimes. Yeah, again, it just creates a really effective transition after that eight bars of intro, and then Ogre comes back in and starts singing. That whole kind of vacuum effect steps up another notch. I love the drums that Kevin programmed for this song. They are so groovy. It's like they just sort of gallop along the track the whole time. Really, really fun. Yeah, there's just something about the way that drum pattern plays in the track that it just sort of just gallops along and maintains this really good groove. Yeah, I love the tones that Kevin dialed up for these drums too. Really kind of old school. Super tight and punchy kick and just that clangy snare drum. I love it. Just a super groovy drum pattern. Now the synth that Kevin created for this main melody, absolutely love this tone. That beautiful reverb at the end of it, when Mark delivered this song to me, he created that reverb and he had it on the whole time on this sound. There was just something really cool about the dry factor of those bells and those overtones and those harmonics that I really liked when I took it out of that space. So I just went in and simply automated that reverb to come on for all the tail notes. Yeah, I love those kind of old school delays. That's the PCM 42 hard at work there. And you know, what is it, 64 milliseconds or something with the feedback knob just cranked? I love that sound.
Hiding so far out.
Check out this vocal transition in the bridge.
Jump the bridge and then it vibes will make you feel the Jim Jones vibe. As if to drink their poison somehow better than what we become. I vaporizing any of this wishful unsafe trip. Catch the bear.
Let's have a listen to that diver sound all by itself. Now, I probably have like 10 synthesizers available to me that I could create that sound with. But what's really cool is when I dug into this, I realized that that was an artifact left over from a really cool vocal effect on Ogre's voice. So what it is it's a TDM version of a harmonizer called the H949 by Eventide. This is like an old school harmonizer that came out before the H3000 series and stuff. Really cool unit. Well, just like the hardware version of that H949, the TDM plugin could just do some incredibly cool things. You could literally have that harmonizer feeding back on itself, as is the case with this. Yeah, check this out.
Crisp and toasted, walk upon, then giving up what we become. All cinders on this rocky road, melted ice cream overload.
Yeah, just a crazy vocal sound through that H949 with some kind of weird feedback. What's really cool is as I kept recording past the end of the vocal line, this H949 did a really crazy feedback thing, ended up creating that diver all by itself.
What we become.
So that was a leftover artifact on that track that I really wasn't expecting. And that is just exactly how it happens most of the time, right? Yeah, I'm not sure I ever shared that with the guys. I don't think that they realized that diver sound was sourced from Ogre's vocal. Probably just thought it was a synth or something. Yeah, just sort of fun finding little gems like that and sort of one of the reasons I love going back to these old sessions. So much fun. Check out this stereo delay that I've got on this vocal as it transitions to the next part.
I'm thinking of saying anything.
So you can see what I often do in this case. Instead of generating a stereo plugin and a bunch of sends and a bunch of automation to make all that happen, I just create a bunch of blank tracks underneath the original. And I'll go into that original vocal and I'll just edit the lyric that I want and copy it into these new tracks. In this case, I just shifted these three regions by quarter notes until I created the effect that I was after. It's sort of a down and dirty way to do some delay automation that doesn't involve a bunch of writing and stuff.
Thinking of saying anything, I'm clinging, I'm out, so out.
You know, I just love these collaborative type of projects. That ultimate benefit of bringing together a bunch of experience in the studio to help produce a track. I mean, in the case of Skinny Puppy, I've talked about this in the past, you know, between Kevin sitting down in his own studio and starting a new idea, or Ogre stepping up to that vocal mic. Now, how many times have those guys done this, right? And just decades of experience. Well, I hope this session inspires you to try some of these simple techniques in your very own productions.
Any of this wishful unsafe trip.